occurs not by trying to be one another's friends, but by discovering you are engaged in common good work that is so determinative, you cannot live without one another. Now, if the church is that, it will talk about friendship in a way that avoids the superficiality of the language of relationship. And because relationships are meant to be spontaneous and short, friendship, if it is the friendship of God, is to be characterized by fidelity, in which you're even willing to tell the friend the truth, which may mean you will risk the friendship. You need to be in that kind of community to survive the loneliness that threatens all of our souls.
Hi, I'm Stephanie. I was pretty challenged by the portion of your talk that dealt with choice and choosing your own story. And I think for many people, and for me especially, the most paradigm-shattering portion of is figuring out how my story fits into this long history, and particularly in the issues of gender. So if choice is not crucial, because for me, in studying scripture, I'm a seminarian. But in studying scripture up to this point, it seems to me that the trajectory for women, hopefully, and for many other groups of people, is a certain kind of freedom. What kind of freedom in Christ should we be looking for if it's not the same kind of freedom of choice?
Yeah. Well, that's a terrific question. Of course, I'm very fortunate. Baylor's motto, and it's not exactly my favorite university, but it has my favorite motto. Baylor's motto is pro ecclesia, pro texana, namely that it names the only two ontological realities that matter. And I happen to have been graced by having both of them determine my life. So I never got to choose whether I wanted to be a Texan. It simply came with the water, and I didn't exactly choose to be a Christian, and I've been trying to figure that out ever since. Even as a slave, as a Christian, you are free. Harsh and dreadful words. Even as a slave, as a Christian, you are free. The tyrant will always be enslaved by their tyranny. The slave at least knows the tyrant, because the slave knows the master better than the master can ever know themselves. Does that mean you want to remain a slave? Does it mean you want to remain forever what 1950s television said women should be? Absolutely not. I take it that it is part of the sanctificationist tradition that if you've been given the Spirit and sanctified, then you get to preach. There's nothing we can say against it because the Spirit is the Spirit. I always think of Diana in George Eliot's Adam Bede and how what she did among the poor in England, as George Eliot depicted it. George Eliot, of course, was not a Christian, being deeply influenced by Feuerbach, but she admired the Methodist in some ways. What I think is the case is we never know how God is going to discipline the church. I'm often known as an Enlightenment basher, and I'm more than willing to have that identification. But I don't think we would have discovered, at least as fully as we have, the significance of women called to the priesthood without the Enlightenment. Praise God for that. Praise God for that. It's not an issue of equality. It is an issue of calling. So that we discovered that women are called to the priesthood is not that everyone should be treated equal, but that equality should be used to make sure that no one with the talent of such calling is denied. But you have to have the good of the calling first. The issue, of course, the important issue is not whether women can be ordained to the priesthood, it's whether how you understand ordination at all. And we haven't adequately discussed that for a long time. I don't in any way mean to suggest that justice should be delayed, but it also has to be patient. That is a hard business. But then I think patience is a central Christian virtue. Thank God we're discovering the readings of the stories of the church that unleashes power in people who didn't think they were main characters but are discovering that they are. That is for the upbuilding of the church. So that's the best answer I can give, but it is it's a wonderful question. And there's no way that you can ever give a definitive answer to it. It always has to be worked out on the ground. Yes.
Hi, I'm Cass. And this morning you equated public education with nationalistic education.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what the possibility of a narrative development for people who are going to think God differently in America would look like within the church, thinking that maybe fundamentalist education isn't quite the answer that is viable if we're not going to ascribe to America's God not being the God that calls us into baptism.
Right. Thank you. The truth of the matter is that we don't know, because those of us that teach at Azusa Pacific got our PhDs from Yale and Chicago. So we continue to reproduce the knowledges that are good for Yale, Chicago, and America in a way that you get to think that that's going to be good for you as a Christian. It is a how we as Christians reclaim knowledges that, I mean, take something very simple. Why do you distinguish between economic departments and political science departments? How did that happen? I mean, if Christians are people that believe that usury is injustice, which I think we should believe, then, as a matter of fact, why should economics not be politicized? It obviously is. So the very fact that you separate economics into a science and political science into gossip, denotes a reality that doesn't strike me as a Christian knowledge. That how you tell the story of America. I mean, what do you remember about America? It is a nation founded in freedom. Wasn't there a war? Did we really know what we were doing when we thought we were throwing the British monarch over and this kind of thing? How we honestly tell the stories of war, it strikes me as extremely important, because in that quote I read from Engel, I mean, war and how it dominates our histories makes the sacrifices of war, not just the sacrifice of the exposure of our lives to death, but the sacrifice of our normal unwillingness to kill. How war, as the major character of historical legitimacy, becomes more determinative than the slow and hard work of the church to be an alternative to war, I think is one of the great challenges we have to figure out how to reclaim. So your question is a challenge for a reconstitution of the knowledges that form us, because the knowledges that form us want us to believe that the way things are is the way things have to be. But what it means to worship the resurrected Christ is it didn't have to happen like that. So exactly how you retell the story to make clear it didn't have to happen like that means that the church and not war is the primary character of the stories we have to tell. And that's going to be a great, if you talk about an intellectual challenge, that's an intellectual challenge.
Yes, I'm not a seminarian, and I'm a layperson. I'm still working on being a failure in profession.
Good.
First before doing any of that. But as a layperson, you know, my life is constituted by a million different practices, just steeped in that tradition, in an alternate story to that story of God. And in the denomination that I'm in, it's being demolished by those alternate stories. And I don't know what my responsibility is or what practical steps you can take. As a commitment to the church, I don't feel bailing on my denomination makes any sense. I don't think it brings me closer to Christ or to his goals for the church. So can you give some practical help for people like us?
Not much. As I said in an earlier session today, you know, I'm an ecclesial whore. I come out of evangelical Methodism, taught for the Lutherans and the Catholics, finally made my way back to Methodism, where I discovered that the Methodists do have a conviction, is that God is nice, and since we're a sanctificationist people, there's a correlative, we ought to be nice too. So I decided I'd just go for class and become an Anglican. But my basic rule is you ought to stay with the people that harmed you. And, you know, what harmed me was those Wesleyan hymns. I mean, Charles Wesley's hymns. I wouldn't be a Christian if it weren't for those things. They were the greatest Eucharistic hymns that were ever written. And so by being an Anglican, I would like to think I'm being true to my Wesleyan roots, since it's all about the reform of the Church of England. And of course, the Episcopal Church isn't the Church of England. It's the Church of America, which is part of the problem. So given my own history, how should I possibly advise you?
Especially struck by what you said about both the religious right and the religious left finding flaw in that they see the state as salvific. Mm-hmm. I work as a faith-based community organizer, uh-huh. So I empower people of faith to get involved in the civic process to create change based on their faith and justice teachings.
Are you IF?
PICO. Uh-huh. Yeah. That's my organization. And so I'm curious, with that in mind, and this is something I really, really struggle with in my work, mm-hmm. seeing the church as the center and the place of salvation and redemption, what does that mean for our relationship, especially with the state and the powers that be, since they do create and sustain poverty and oppression?
Right.
How then do we relate and engage with them in a meaningful and prophetic way?
Yeah. Let me just recommend Bill Kavanaugh's new book is just out called... the religious myth of religious violence, and it's all about the story of how you had to have the rise of the state to stop Catholics and Protestants from killing one another. So the state becomes a soteriological instrument in modernity that is more peaceful than the church, and he explodes that myth completely. If I understand, what I really respect, and I don't know PICO that well, but I know the IAF pretty well, and what I really respect about the IAF is community organizing is a way to have people share stories in a way that creates power that otherwise would not exist, that the state cannot use. You use the state. It's very tricky. It's very tricky because what you use turns out oftentimes to use you. So I really think, and I understand that there's always a kind of tension involved because it's so-called faith-based organizing. I mean, my church isn't a faith-based, it's the truth.
Yeah.
You worry about instrumentalizing the church, but as long as you've got that worry, it seems to me that the kind of organizing, that kind of community organizing, is really some of the most imaginative politics we have, exactly because people discover goods in common through debate that they otherwise would not be able to locate. So that's real political community rather than the kind of bureaucratic manipulation you get at the strong state level. So I think it's a very, it's a great good. I mean, you don't go out and ask, hey, let's get together as human beings, qua human beings. You get your people concerned about, don't we need a stoplight? Right? Do I understand the kind of thing you do? And that seems to me to be really good. I mean, that's exactly the kind of community building that we desperately need because it's good work to do. Yes.
Dr. Hauerwas, going back to your notion of freedom and America's God, I was thinking about something that bolsters the notion that we're free people and we participate in America's God, and that's the issue of voting. And what's interesting is that voting is something that both the left and the right call us to do based on our duty as Americans. And my real question is, should Americans vote? If so, how do should American Christians vote? And how do we negotiate that obligatory notion of voting as Christians?
Don't vote. It only encourages them. Mike Bass. Mike Baxter said that. Don't vote. It only encourages them. Mike is head of the Catholic Peace Movement at Notre Dame. Voting is never an end in itself. Voting is only the procedural means to have a social order, have the debates it should have for the discovery of goods in common that are otherwise impossible without the debate taking place. Otherwise, voting is a form of coercion in which 51% get to tell 49% how to live. And that is the reason why Mennonites and Quakers have deep problems with voting, because it's a coercive form of life antithetical to a community that is about living nonviolently. When I taught at Notre Dame, I had students, Mennonite students, very impressive people, who lived in a commune over in Goshen, and they rented a house and to live together, and that the man that owned the house decided to sell the house, and he wanted to sell it to them, and they had long discussions about this, but one of the people in the commune, a doctor, didn't think that Christians should own property. So it was a vote like 5-1. And the five did not force their majority, but instead spent a whole year studying scripture with him to try to figure out if he was right or wrong. They finally, and I don't know whether this is a good outcome or not, he finally decided that there was a way of owning property in which it did not possess you. And so he decided that the community could buy the house. That's democracy. it's hard, long work. And how elections became a form of legitimation and the exemplification of democracy just beats the hell out of me. Yes.
Hello, my name is Sam. You had said something in your speech about Christians who say, Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world, but that's just my personal opinion.
Yeah.
And I'm one of those people that says that a lot.
You'll never say it again.
Yeah. And I guess how
I've given you a great gift.
Yes. How does one move on from that, or just how do you reconcile kind of this, for lack of a better term, postmodern way of looking at it? And
well, first of all, remember that the last thing in the world you want to be is tolerant. Tolerance is a position of power, in which you get to tolerate someone you really don't like, which shows you're superior. I believe Jesus Christ is Lord, but just my personal opinion, is a position that is fundamentally shaped by the public-private distinction in America, that creates the presumption that our most cherished convictions are private because they're too controversial to be made public. And we simply, as Christians, cannot live with that. Thank you. And therefore, there is nothing more important. I said earlier today, I had a Jewish colleague for many years at Notre Dame that always said that any religion that doesn't tell you what to do with your pots and pans and genitals cannot be interesting. And pots and pans obviously have to do with economics, genitals are plain. And exactly what the church must do is to challenge that distinction between public and private, just to the extent it is a distinction that implies, one, that what we believe as Christians is irrational, and therefore it is not subject to discipline debate, and two, that it is politically divisive. The first presumption is clearly wrong. The second presumption is clearly right. And you've got to be ready to take that risk of being divisive. The problem with the fundamentalists is not that they go public with their religious convictions, but that the religious convictions with which they go public are so stupid. Did I say that in a too nuanced way?
Actually, I apologize to all the people who have been waiting patiently, but I want to be respectful for the time of everyone else here. And we have scheduled our lectureship to 8 o'clock, and so at this time, we will be bringing the lectureship and question and answers to a close. But I encourage you to continue talking with one another. There are still refreshments over here, so feel free to share with one another. Let's thank Dr. Hauerwas one more time.
From this, you